Well, today we're going to look at two of the methods that have really come to the fore in recent weeks, not just here at Gold Valley, but on most commercial fisheries. The two methods I'm looking at today, we haven't really covered that much in any of the e-magazines. The first method is dobbing, or flicking towards fish. It's dobbing is how it's known in the match fishing world. And like you probably know, there's been a lot of big matches recently, one on this, and it's quite a simple method. Basically, you're looking to spot fish. You're sat on your box with your rig in your hand and you're not fishing, you're just looking to spot fish. Those fish that are cruising around and looking for a little bit of bait, and that if you swing it in the right place and drop it right in front of their nose, they will definitely have a go. There's been matches won here in the last month with over £250 on this method, and myself have had bags in matches over £100. Everything's got to be right, the wind's got to be coming in, and obviously the fish have got to be in the surface layers. But when it is right, it is a deadly, deadly method. Sometimes you can even pick out the bigger fish, the ones that you want. This is on rare occasions, but when you can do this, the weight is built up very, very quickly. The second method I'm going to look at today is fishing just down the shelf with paste. Again, on a lot of commercial venues throughout the country, paste is definitely starting to work. You can always tell when paste is going to work because the method feeder starts to produce some big weights and the carp are getting turned onto ground bait. Then when they start to come in close during the end of the day or the end of the match, paste can definitely again put a big weight in your net very, very quickly. So the two methods that we're looking at today is number one, dobbing. If we see a few, it's been quite a cold night and I have seen one or two fish cruising around, but it's the sort of method you can have ready, a bit of hair-rigged meat or hair-rigged pellet, but that's something that we'll talk about more in depth later. But you can have the rig ready, you can be fishing on your paste line, top six we're going to be fishing today, slightly to our right, down the shelf. And if you see a fish cruising, that can be shipped in very quick, your swinging rig can be put on and dobbed in front of the fish and hopefully catch these fish. You've got to be a little bit careful because you don't want to end up chasing shadows and going nowhere. But when these fish are cruising around on top and having a little bit of a go, you cannot ignore them. I'm going to run through the tackle that I'll be using today. Firstly, the dobbing rig. Again, very simple. Size 12 eyed hook, a nice big hook. Again, you're not going to be hooking small fish. You're going to be seeing the fish that you're going for, so they're going to be carp. You'll notice I've got a quick stop here. Now, I have messed around a lot fishing like this in the evenings, just trying to see what the best bait is, from expander pellets to hard pellets to sweet corn to bunches of maggots to luncheon meat. And definitely luncheon meat does seem to be the best. You can swing it at the fish and it tends to hit the water, make a bit of a noise, but sink very slowly. Unlike hard pellets or expanders, when they soaked up some water, they tend to sink very quickly. And you're looking to get that little plop on the water to get the fish's attention. The fish turns and it's still in the surface layers, still quite high up. So hair rig luncheon meat is a must. Now, why the hair rigging? Again, this is quite simple. It's nothing to do with hooking the fish. You'll hook as many fish by putting the meat on the hook. What this is to do with is so that I can get a couple of swings at each fish. If I swing at a fish and I miss a bite, 9 times out of 10, if it's on the hook, it will come off. If I put it on the hair, I can have a couple more swings at the fish and hopefully get the fish. Now again, a lot of people when they're dobbing, they do fish very, very shallow. And this for me is a big no-no. You'll see I'm fishing about 14 to 15 inches deep. And this is to keep the float and the shot away from where the fish is going to be. Two reasons: I don't want the float or the shot to spook the fish, and also I don't want the fish to be more attracted by the splash of the float than the splash of the bait. You'll see that's a 0.5 Drennan dibber with 4 or 5 number 8 shots situated below it, 020 line, again very strong and durable. You'll see the length of the line is very different compared to other rigs as well. This is purely because I want the freedom to be able to swing at distance from these fish and keep the pole tip away from the fish. The elastic purple hydro, again, very beefed up, very strong, very durable gear, all to suit the fish that we're fishing for. Hair rig luncheon meat, a nice decent bit on the hair, is definitely the number one bait. I'm now going to show you the rig I'm going to use for fishing paste. Like always, when you're fishing paste, you're targeting big fish. You might well catch some bream or some other fish, but 90% of your bites are going to be from carp. Hence the strong and durable tackle. A size 12 gamma carp hook to 020 line direct. The float choice is a Series 8 Dawa 0.6. Again, it's made for paste fishing. You can see the very long tip lined through the body for extra strength and durability. Like I say, we're fishing direct. Again, purple hydro through a power kit, a CTK5. You'll notice that I've got a pot situated on the pole quite a way back. This is just to house the hook bait and a few loose pellets every cast. Like I say, I like to use quite a wet paste, not too stiff at all. So this is put into the pot, which is deposited into the swim. Again, that's something that we can run by when we're actually fishing the method. Just a quick mention, both tops are rigged up with a puller kit. Again, I know purple hydro is very, very strong, but these fish really do pull. And to catch big weights quick, you do need to give them some stick. So a puller kit is essential. So they're the two rigs that I've run through that we're going to use in today's session. I have got duplicates in my box in case of any breakages. These fish really will be pulling hard. I'm now going to run through the bait and the feeding techniques that I'm going to be using in today's e-magazine. I'm now going to run through the bait for today's session, starting with the meat. Now this is purely for the dobbing rig. Like I say, hair rig meat is definitely the number one bait in my opinion. I've got a few different sizes there. The meat cutter I use, I've bent the wire slightly so I do get a variation of sizes. And the slightly bigger sizes are definitely best. Not only do they make a little bit more noise, but they're very visual and they don't sink so fast. Like I say, these are the main reasons for meat being the number one dobbing bait. So that's the luncheon meat. Going on to the paste line, what I'm going to be doing when I put the paste in the pot is topping the pot up with some 6mm fishery pellets. This is just to create a little base, something for the fish to home in on. While I'm actually fishing, I am going to be throwing in some 8mm fishery pellets. Like I say, the fish here at the moment are really tuned into noise, as they are on a lot of commercial fisheries. And just by throwing 4 or 5 8mm pellets, not all the time, just every 4 or 5 minutes, can just create that noise to pull extra fish into your peg. And to the business end, the paste. The paste is made up of old ghost bloodworm paste and old ghost krill powder. It's a paste that I've had a lot of success on in the last couple of weeks, and definitely know that the fish like this. The bloodworm just adds that natural tang to it, and it's a nice bright orange colour, which again is very, very visible. In amongst some fishery pellets, just at the bottom of the shelf, should definitely result in a few bites. Also, the reason why I think this line will be good. Just lately, there's been quite a bit of rain and a little bit of cold weather. Although we're into the summer, supposedly, it is still quite cold. And just targeting fish, we have done this before in a couple of e-magazines, but not for a while and definitely not with paste. But targeting fish at the bottom of that near shelf can really result in some big bags of fish. Just because the fish aren't in the edge, it doesn't mean that they're not near to it. We're fishing in about 5 foot of water on a top six at a slight angle down into the deeper water. There's a little bit of wind trundling in here and I'm sure we should get some bites off that. And it's a line that a lot of anglers seem to neglect. Like I've said, just because the fish aren't in the edge, it doesn't mean that they're a million miles away. And I think today that will be a really good line for us. So I've shown you the rigs, I've shown you the bait. Now I'm going to feed a little bit of bait in close and I'm going to start looking for those fish to see if I can see one cruising and try and catch a few fish early by dobbing the little bit of meat around. Like I say, if they're not about, I can go onto my paste line, hopefully catch some fish, but all the time keeping an eye out for those cruisers, those ones that I can mug off the surface with the dobbing rig. We'll be right back. Here we are, and like I said before we started, the weather is quite adverse. They'd forecast it to brighten up and it's gone completely the other way. More overcast, quite a bit of wind. I have foul hooked and lost a carp, and I've had two decent bream. Just lately started to get a few indications, and I think it will be the back end of the session where we actually put a few fish together. Again, for the dobbing rig, the weather's just gone totally against us, but I'm still keeping an eye out if it does warm up and if there are any fish cruising around. But it's not just the weather that puts the fish down, it's the fact that when it's dull and overcast, they're a lot harder to actually spot. So I think our best chance of putting a few fish together now is on the short line with paste. Like I say, I have had a few indications. We've had two bream and I have foul hooked a carp. But I do expect as the session goes on for this line to get definitely stronger. I'm just loose feeding a few 8mm and cupping in some 6mm with the paste. And like I say, it's quite a while before we had any indications, but just recently I've missed three or four bites, caught another bream and foul hooked a carp. So hopefully things are starting to look up even though the weather isn't. The one main difference today that you've probably noticed is the size of the pole cup that I'm fishing with on the pole. Normally I use little tiny cad pots just to put in enough loose offerings to keep the fish interested. Fishing with paste is a little bit different because you're actually putting your hook bait in the pot so it doesn't come off when you're shipping out. And it's the ideal opportunity to put some loose offerings, some 6mm pellets in very accurately on top of your hook bait as well. So that's why the pole pot that I'm fishing with on the pole today is just that little bit bigger, just to house the hook bait and enough loose offerings, hopefully to keep some fish interested or to even pull some fish into the swim. Well, here we are well into the session. I've had two carp and a couple of skimmers. I've had a few indications, but the conditions have really been against us and what we've tried to do in today's session. But we have still had a few signs and indications. Twice I've gone onto the dobbing rig because I've seen one swim past, but they're very spooky and they really just do not want to know today. There's not been a lot of fish caught all the way around the lake. And I think it just goes to show that no matter what you pick, if the conditions are against you, it can be very difficult, but we've still managed a couple of decent fish so far, and I'm hopeful that the last bit of the session will produce a few more fish. We're certainly on the right method to catch a few decent fish late on. And like I say, definitely have more and more indications as the session's gone on. I've stopped loose feeding purely because, you know, it just didn't seem to be pulling any fish in the peg. Maybe I was being a little bit too positive early on this line especially, by throwing in pellets and cupping pellets. And since I've just been cupping in the hook bait paste with a few 6mm, I've definitely had a lot more indications. About 10 minutes ago, we had our second carp, which was a decent fish. So I'm hoping that the tail end of the session produces a few more decent fish. I'm still keeping an eye out. If I do see one swim past, I definitely have a dob at it. But the two that I have seen have been very, very spooky, and they seem to be almost swirling because something spooked them rather than them feeding off the surface. So I think it's just been one of those days where the fish have been hard to come by. But like I say, we've still a bit of the session left, and hopefully we'll catch a couple more fish. There's an indication there then. Like I say, I've had a few indications and most of them have been fast unders, which are either line bites or indications from smaller fish. It really is a case on pace that striking at almost everything because sometimes you can get lifts. But like I say, most of the bites that are off of decent fish hooked in the mouth will be under and really fast. The paste I've used today is very simple to make. It's the old ghost bloodworm paste. It's about 20% this. A lot of natural ingredients, a lot of bloodworm in there. You can see the dried bloodworm. Really is a very tangy, natural bait. To that, and this makes up about 75-80% of the mix, is the old ghost krill. Really is a fantastic bait to make paste with. As you would do with ground bait, just mix it all together when it's dry thoroughly, making sure that everything's mixed together 100%. You don't want to mix it with water and have little rich bits. You can see there that that's pretty well dispersed through the whole mix. Again, it will soak up a bit of water, very much like ground bait, which is why you've probably noticed today I've had a two or three times just got a little bit of water with my pole cup, had a little bowl of water next to me just to keep dampening it off. And like I say, very much like ground bait, you do have to play around with it a little bit. You just want it on the damp side so that that hook can be pulled through it nice and easily when you strike. Really is a lovely smell, this. Fantastic, not just for carp but for bream as well. There you can see, that's the sort of consistency. So that if you squeeze it, you can almost pull it through your fingers and through your hand. That sort of doughy, wet dough consistency. And a small ball can be made quite easily. Now this will dry out, but like I say, while you're fishing, you can just play with it and get it absolutely dead right for the next cast. But like I said, very simple, but very, very effective mix. I'm now going to show you how I've hooked the paste on today. It's quite simple. Just make a very small ball in between your finger and your thumb. You can see you can vary the size of the paste. If you get pestered with little fish, it's best to put a slightly bigger piece on. Then, when the ball's formed, just cut the line into the paste and pull the hook into it centrally. And then just shape it off. It's quite a nice firm paste. And there you go. That's going to stay on there for quite a while. You only get to strike once because obviously a good strike will pull the hook straight out of it. You can see a nice bright visual paste there, and that's what we've caught our fish on today. Well, there we go. We've reached the end of the session. It has been quite difficult. It is a funny time of year, to be fair, and we have had a few fish in our peg at the end of the session. I did lose two carp, ended up with five carp and three decent bream. Like I say, there are ways today where we could have sat here and caught a lot of fish, straight lead, method feeder, or right in the edge, like we did last month with the dead maggots. But these e-magazines are all about covering new and upcoming methods that are taking places apart. I've not managed to catch on the swinging rig today, dobbing, but it can be a very, very effective method. And I hope the way that I set it up and explained it to you stands you in good stead. You've got to look for these fish cruising around and just aim in front of them, making that luncheon meat make a little bit of a plop, and they'll just turn and take it. Set the float, like I say, 14 or 15 inches deep. Keep the float away from it a little bit. I think also towards the end of the session, we've seen just how good the paste line can be. There's been quite a few bites and we've landed two or three decent sized common carp right at the end of the session. Missed a few bites, and on a day when that line hasn't really come good and you probably would have caught more a bit close in, I think it definitely goes to show that if you can pick this line on the right day, those slightly colder days when the fish aren't going to come in, then it can be even better. Just to recap, on the swinging and dobbing rig, definitely be looking for fish and don't be afraid to ship in like I did today. Put the rig you're fishing with down or even reel your feeder in and go and have a look for this fish. See if you can mug it, see if you can get it just to take your bait. Because a lot of the fish that are cruising around on the surface can be those real big ones and they can make a massive difference at the end of the day. As far as the paste line's concerned, I do like to feed it quite often and quite aggressive because normally you're fishing for a big weight of fish. Today, however, being slightly negative, definitely got us some more inquiries, some more indications, and at the end, a few more bites. We haven't caught a bag full of fish, but I think we've learnt a lot, and I've definitely put some ghosts to rest as far as different lines are concerned. And also, what is good with a dobbing rig, if you can't see the fish, you don't need to pick it up. It really is a case of setting it up, having it there on your roost, and only picking it up when you can see the fish in front of you. You might have seen earlier when I was trying to catch a fish dobbing that I actually stood up. This is purely a visual thing. It's all about seeing the fish, it's all about watching the fish, seeing what way the fish is swimming and putting your bait right in front of the fish's mouth and head. If you can do this, you'll definitely catch more. Don't be afraid to stand up. A lot of people are, but these fish are cruising around. You can stand up and you can get a real good view. So like I say, when you're dobbing, don't be afraid. It won't affect your other lines too much. And it will definitely, as far as visual is concerned, stand you in better stead of actually hooking that fish. Well, there we go. That's what we've ended up with today. A few carp and bream, all on pace. We've not caught any on the dobbing rig. Not the biggest net of fish that we've caught. But like I've always said, practicing and days like today aren't always about filling your nets. It's about finding out how to catch them and what are the best methods. Like I say, with the dobbing, keep your eyes peeled. Don't be afraid to stand up and have a good look. You get decent fish like this one cruising around, you'll be able to spot it, flick your rig on top of it, and definitely have a massive chance of catching it. Also, that edge line with the paste just down the shelf can be absolutely deadly when the weather's right. The last hour of our session, I hooked 5 or 6 carp there, which in a normal match could be enough to push you from there or thereabouts to winning the match.